For Khama Media's Polity, I'm Zanele Dlamini, activist and former GCIS CEO Themba Maseko is in conversation with Polity about his book titled For My Country, Why I Blew the Whistle on Zuma and the Guptas. So, Mr. Maseko, you were brave enough to stand up against our former president, Jacob Zuma, and the Gupta brothers when they were trying to force you to follow their illegal and corrupt orders. How do you feel now that the Crown Court has sentenced former president, Jacob Zuma, to serve time in jail?
Look, I think it's good progress we're making as a country, because one of the reasons why corruption has become so entrenched and embedded in our social fabric has largely because no one has been held accountable. And the fact that you have the former president of the country who defied a constitutional ruling being sent to prison, it's a sign that we're beginning to see signs that people are being held accountable.
And how does it make you feel now that our country's democratic project has been so derailed by corruption and state capture? Do you think that the country can again find a correct course towards democracy and economic development?
Well, I'm feeling extremely optimistic at this stage. I think that we are moving in the right direction. The fact that we have the National Prosecuting Authority also beginning to do its work to prosecute those who are implicated in corruption, to realize that the hawks are also starting to arrest people who have been implicated in corruption, for example, arrests for the VBS thievery that took place. It's a sign that we're moving in the right direction. This judgment is actually asserting the independence of the judiciary, is something that all of us should be celebrating. So at this stage, I'm feeling very optimistic about the future of our country.
You were politicized from a very young age and growing up in Soweto. As a schoolboy, you were even involved in June 16, 1976 uprising. What do you remember about that day?
Well, the day had a major impact on my life because, I mean, I was still a kid, 12, 13 years old. And then government came up with this policy that education was going to be offered to all African kids in Afrikaans. And I found that totally unacceptable. And in the beginning of the year of June of 1976, actually, my primary school, which was Bele Primary in Orlando West, had decided to go on strike as early as January of that year. So by the time the June 16 uprising unfolded, we had been out of class for many months. So my memories of that day is just a very cold day in Soweto, wearing my white shirt and jersey, and going to participate in a peaceful demonstration. And I still remember that when we arrived at the venue outside Orlando West High School, we're still waiting for more students to come. And I then saw a number of police vans arriving, what we used to call then hippos. And whilst we're still waiting for more students to come, then gunshots went off and I had screams. For the first time, I smelled tear gas as a kid. I just heard screams of kids, literally kids. And I just found it totally unacceptable that the government would actually send police with arms to come and shoot at school kids. And I just heard fire shots and I ran into a church nearby and I hid there for what appeared to be eternity. And when I came out, all I could see was just tens of kids, school kids lying on the ground with their shirts covered in blood. And I think I realized that some of them may have died on the spot because of the shooting. And that was something that actually struck me for a better part of my adult life, actually.
Like many Black families, you share how your parents tried by all means to raise you and your siblings. Life was hard, but thanks to your parents, you were the first child, Mr. Maseko, to matriculate in your family. I was even touched when your father was even prepared to sell his car to fund your tertiary tuition fees. Can you tell us about that?
Well, I came from a fairly biggish family, although not very big by African family standards. Kids of seven with two parents, but in my family, we always had visitors of people who were staying with us. And my father was the breadwinner and the only person working. And he worked at some point, I remember, 18-hour day shift just to make sure that he puts food on the table, but also made sure that we went to school. And he was a very strict gentleman who made sure that He wanted his kids to have a better life than him, and the only route he thought was through education. And I took quite a bit from that because I knew that if I did not go to school, I was going to receive punishment. And he did all he could to make sure that all of us went to school. But unfortunately, my siblings dropped out and they couldn't continue their studies. And I think June 16 had a lot to do with it, because after the uprising, many, many young Black South Africans actually lost interest in education and never went to school. But I persevered, largely because of the support and insistence from my parents that I must continue with schooling. And that's how I ended up going to finish my matric, and surprised to realize that I actually passed very well and qualified to go to university. And that's when I applied to vets, only to be told that because I was a Black child, I could not go to a white university. And that's when I went to enroll at the University of Zululand. So yes, I give credit to both my parents for their support to make sure that I finish school.
Let's talk about your mother now. Even though she knew that you were involved in politics, but she didn't want to tell your dad. She even gave you money at times so that you will go attend the meetings. What can you say about your mother? She sounded like, when I read it, it's one of those ladies that are incredible.
My mother was a very special human being. I mean, she came from the rural parts of Mpumalanga now, Eastern Transvaal then, an area called Emelo. And she never had the opportunity to go to school. But she knew that the only way we could have a better life was if we went to get good quality education. And she supported us. I mean, I understand now that, you know, she tried to help me with my homework. And most of the time, she couldn't understand what I was going through in terms of my schooling. And when June 76 happened, and I started participating in mass meetings and protests, she was very unhappy with it, but she quietly supported me and made sure that, in fact, I had always money in my pocket to buy some food, to have transport, to go to meetings that were taking place in all parts of Soweto. But she was a loving mother. I still have memories of her. When I came back on June 16, late in the afternoon, and I found her in tears because she did not know whether I was alive or not. And she just gave me one of the best hugs I've ever had in my whole life. So she has a very special place in my heart.
There's a lady that you're also speaking about in the book. I think it's Aus Caroline, who also motivated you to go all out and repeat a grade. And she was with you. Tell us about that chapter in your life, Mr. Maseko.
Well, Mom, Aus Caroline was actually a neighbor who had a house just two houses from mine, who took interest in me because she could see that I actually loved schooling. I was committed to it. And when I failed grade 7 or 9, I can't recall now, she found me sobbing, crying. And she asked me what was going on. I said, no, listen, I just got my results. I failed. And she said, you know what, my boy, go back to school. This is not the end of it. Go and try again. And if you do well, if you promise me that you do well, I'll find you a better school. And when I passed the following year, she then found a place for me at a Catholic private school in Soweto. And that's when I actually ended up finishing my matric. But I still recall that she took me in as one of her own. And I call her my second mom, because she made sure that, in fact, after school, I had a proper supper. She invited me to dinner with her kids and husband, and I became part of their family. And so she also became a second mom. And I hope that, you know, there are adults out there who could actually take something from that, to identify a kid who needs help and offer them support, because I'm where I am today, largely because of her contribution as well. So Aus Caroline is my second mom.
You found a mentor, if I may say so, Sydney Mufamadi, while you were also like growing your activism role within the ANC. Can you please reflect on this period of your life?
Well, that was when I became an activist. I mean, I went to University of Zululand. There was violence and I couldn't go back. So I went back to vets. Fortunately, I was admitted. But at that point, after my experiences as a kid in June 16, and then also experiencing violence, almost losing my life at the University of Zululand when we were attacked by Inkatha, I went to vets. And when I got to vets, I decided I was going to become an activist. And as an activist at vets, we made a commitment that we're not going to be involved in political activities on campus only, but we'll also participate in the community. So we worked with trade unions civic associations, women's movement. And that's when I came across a number of leaders of what we used to term then the mass democratic movement. And Sidney Mufumadi identified me as one of those committed, young, dedicated activists. And he took me under his wing and became my political mentor. And he gave me a lot of literature to read. He taught me politics. He made me understand why we needed to be involved in struggle and how I should recruit other youngsters to be part of the struggle. And he became my political mentor even when I became an adult participating in government. He was always somebody who was there. He was like a second father to me. And I, to this day, still recognize him as one of the best committed, ethical leaders who act with absolute integrity. I mean, Sydney, in my view, is an example of what an ANC leader was, is, and should be.
Wow. And at the dawn of democracy now, Mr. Maseko, you were appointed, I think it was 1995, as the Superintendent General at the Gauteng Department of Education. What were the challenges that you experienced in this position?
Well, that was probably one of the most important full-time jobs I had as a young man, because after 1994, I became a member of parliament and I just got bored sitting in those parliamentary benches. And I decided to look for, because I thought my time was not well spent sitting in those benches. So I applied for a job and was appointed as head of Gauteng department. And my task was to set up a single education department in Gauteng, the first non-racial education department, which became the Gauteng Department of Education, GDE as it is known today. And our biggest challenge was basically to integrate the four education departments that existed for colored, Indian, African, and white kids. And we had to integrate them into a single education system. And we encountered challenges, which included the fact that the white education system was well equipped with all the resources the kids required. They had the most qualified teachers with university degrees. Whereas on the other end of the scale, you had the African education department, which was called the DET, the Department of Education and Training, which had with schools with no resources, no toilets, no laboratories, no sports fields, no textbooks, highly underqualified teachers. And we also had to integrate systems such as putting together a single education system, putting together a single platform to pay salaries of teachers, and just motivating African teachers to be committed to education once again, because most of them had given hope on the education system in the country. And we actually worked very hard to build a single education department. And today, GDE is one of the best performing departments in the country, largely because of the generation of officials I worked with. One of my biggest challenges was, of course, the fact that I was at the age of 29, I think, and I was leading a team of highly qualified, highly experienced education administrators from all the four departments. And I was the youngest in the team, and managing all of these people who came with different experiences, different cultural backgrounds, religious experiences, bringing them together and managing them into a single team was probably a big challenge that I think I performed extremely well. And we ended up becoming one of the best leadership team in the education department.
It must have been a very daunting task, because I also come from a school where if you look at the school grounds compared to what you are saying in the book, that the school grounds of the schools were worse than the ones that you see in prison at the time. It must have been a difficult era indeed.
It was a challenge, because I mean, I grew up in that very education system where you go to class and there's no teaching, there's no textbooks, there's no materials, there are broken windows, you don't even have a proper toilet. And to end up being head of that department, in my view, was coming full circle. And it made it easier for me to understand the challenges that school kids were experiencing, the challenges that teachers were experiencing, and I was able to provide as much support as possible. But obviously, government did not give us enough funding to address all of these challenges. And I'm sad that a lot of the challenges that I experienced as a kid in those schools that we had to solve when I was head of department, those challenges are still existing today. I mean, kids still go to schools with no facilities, with no libraries, no laboratories. Those school grounds that you're talking about haven't changed. There's still a lot of work that needs to be done. But I think my generation of leaders we did our best to improve the lot of those kids.
You also served as the GCIS CEO in the 2000s, and you enjoyed a very good working relationship with former President Thabo Mbeki as well as Minister Aziz Farhat. Can you tell us about that?
When I left Gauteng, I mean, I got an opportunity to work in national government, started at Public Works, and then the best years of my working career was as CEO of GCIS, where I worked with a lot of professional communicators to manage that portfolio. And yes, my boss, initial boss, was Aziz Farhat, whom I consider as actually one of the best leaders I worked with when I was in that portfolio. And we were fortunate because when I was there, we also had a president who fully understood the importance of communicating what government was doing to communities out there and making sure that we always have the government voice existing out there so that people knew what was going. So I enjoyed that stint, although working with Thabo Mbeki was quite a challenge because he was a leader who paid so much, and sometimes I say too much attention to detail. So when you were working with him, you needed to make sure that you knew what you were talking about. You had to do your research because on every aspect of your work, it turned out that he actually knew more about what you were talking about than him, largely because he did his homework, he did his research. So those were the good times in government.
And you were at the center of the story that made international headlines when Thabo Mbeki suspended the National Director of Public Prosecutions, Vusi Pikoli, who was insisting at the time that Police Minister Jackie Selebi's arrest was imminent. What are your reflections on this episode?
Well, that was a very difficult episode because, I mean, I give more details in the book. Mm. I still want people to go and buy the book and read it there. But a National Public Prosecutor... his job is actually protected in the Constitution. And I thought it would be important for proper processes and procedures to be followed before that suspension happens. So as I reflect on it, I think that Mbeki at the time may have had good reasons why he needed to take that decision. I mean, he was concerned about the potential conflict between the National Prosecutor and the National Police Commissioner. So he wanted to manage that situation. But the suspension of Pikoli, in my view, was something that was taken a little bit prematurely, and it could have been delayed until proper procedures were followed. So that was quite a difficult moment to manage, because it would be tantamount to President Cyril Ramaphosa today suspending Shamila Botohi, who's the new head of NDPP, which would actually create havoc in the public sector or public service system. So I think that procedures are now in place, and I don't think something like that would be possible where the president can simply suspend the NDPP. So there's a proper process that needs to be followed now.
And you also worked in former President Jacob Zuma's office for some time. How would you describe the difference between Mbeki and Zuma's style of operation?
Well, the first thing to mention there is that as the head of government communication, it's important for one to have access to the president who's head of the state, because you're speaking not just on behalf of government, but you're speaking on behalf of cabinet as a whole. With Mbeki, I had unfettered access to him. So if there was an issue, an important issue that needed to be communicated, I always knew that I could pick up a call and discuss matters with him. I'll have a meeting. And things were working fairly smoothly under him. But when it came to President Zuma, the former president, it became very difficult because as head of GCIS, I was denied access. I mean, during my stint, I think with him, it must have been about a year or so, I never had a single meeting with him. All my requests for a meeting were denied. All my attempts to speak to him directly were denied. So it made my job very difficult because you're communicating, in other words, on the president's behalf, but you don't have access to plan and discuss issues with President Zuma. So that was difficult. I noted that, in fact, when Mbeki was president, it was clear that, you know, Mbeki understood issues of governance, the challenges that government faced, and he was always there in the cabinet lichutlas and cabinet meetings to give very good direction to say, this is the way we need to take as government. Whereas under Zuma, you got a sense that, in fact, Zuma did not pay enough attention to issues of governance. So he wasn't always there to give direction to ministries and the government as a whole. And the difficulty with Zuma's presidency was also the frequency of cabinet reshuffles. And there was very little understanding that, in fact, when you reshuffle cabinet and you change departments, you lose up to 18 months of delivery because people have to start from scratch, building a new department, training, or giving information to the new ministers. And the difficulty being that the new ministers did not always want to carry the work that was done by the predecessors. So they wanted to start from scratch. And that meant that, in fact, service delivery suffered in many different ways, largely because President Zuma was taking these decisions without thinking through what the practical administrative and financial implications would be of his decision. One classical example would be, for instance, his decision to give free education to university students. That decision was not properly considered. The financial implications were not properly understood. National Treasury was not consulted. And that is why we have a crisis to this day, because President Zuma may have taken a decision that he thought was a good decision, good for young people in this country, but did not understand that there needed to be proper, thorough investigation and planning before such a decision is announced.
And even chapter 10, titled, I Decide to Speak, it's heartbreaking to read about the pressure you were under when you decided to go public as well as to expose corruption. Can you tell us about this difficult time in your life?
The first point to make is that at that time, my decision was not to become a whistleblower or to speak out. It was simply defying Zuma and the Guptas because they wanted me to do something that I considered to be illegal, unprocedural, and I decided to defy, and that's why I ended up losing my job there. But as I was sitting at home unemployed and watching how government was, I started realizing that the problem wasn't just about GCIS. The Gupta family had a bigger plan to actually loot state resources in all government departments, in all state-owned enterprises. And that's when I decided to actually speak out, when I heard that fake mentor was being offered a cabinet position because the Guptas wanted her to cancel a route, one of the most lucrative routes for SAA, Joburg to Mumbai, because they wanted to put one of their companies into that position. When I heard that ABC Jonas was offered 600 million rands and offered the finance minister's job by the Guptas, then I realized that something was terribly going wrong in the country. And that's when I decided to speak out. And when I did, then you experience some kind of isolation. Your own comrades and friends stay away from you because they consider you as somebody who snitched on their leaders. And it led to a lot of isolation, political isolation. I lost lots of friends. I lost a lot of comrades. But at a personal level, you then start experiencing many challenges of a financial nature because I could not get a job in the public service. I could not get a job in the private sector, because I was perceived as a political risk. I could not even raise funds to start a business because banks decided that, in fact, I was a political risk and I did not have any form of income, so I could not get a job. So it was a very difficult and dark moment in my life. Nonetheless, I don't regret speaking out. I think that our country needed to know what was happening behind the scenes.
And the level of the arrogance from the Gupta family. I remember this one call that you received. I think you were on your way to Sun City.
I will never forget that call from Ajay Gupta when he was calling me, demanding that I have a meeting with him on a Saturday morning. And when I told him that I'm already out of town and insisted that I must actually meet him the following day. And that's when I told him, I used an expletive and told him where to get off. But the arrogance and the brazenness, the tone of his voice, where he was talking as if he was actually the president of the country, could give me an instruction, I found that totally, totally unacceptable. And that's why I decided to, you know, even swear at him in that conversation, because I thought, what a nerve for somebody who's not in government, an immigrant who had just arrived in the country, to begin to give instructions to senior government officials I considered to be extremely, extremely unacceptable. And I saw this arrogance as well in the meeting that I had with him at his house in Saxon Weld, where he told me very blatantly that he had weekly meetings with President Zuma, and that if I have challenges in getting money from other departments that he needed me to give to his companies, he will summon those ministers to his house and give them instructions to transfer their budgets to the GCIS budget so that I could transfer it to him. So that just the arrogance that he displayed in those instances made me find it totally, totally unacceptable.
How do you feel now, Mr. Maseko, that this book is out and the truth is out and everything that you wanted out there is out there?
This is, I call this my third baby, because it gave me the opportunity to actually reflect on all these experiences, from my schooling to my involvement in politics and involvement in government. It was a very therapeutic experience sitting down and writing this book, because I even was able to reflect on my father's death, my mother's death, Baek Imlangeni's killing, which I actually experienced in ways that hurt me in a very deep way. So this book gave me an opportunity to again tell my own story in my own words, because my story had been told by journalists and analysts, and I just wanted to tell this story in my own way, because in most cases in struggles or revolutions, people who are involved in struggles often don't tell their stories. In fact, they take their stories to the grave. So it's important that those of us who are involved can tell our stories in our own words. And that's what this book gave me an opportunity to. And I think that it's a contribution to history that I think I'm making. And hopefully young people, when they read it, they will see that in fact, not all public servants, not all activists, not all members of the ANC join the struggle to just steal money from the public purse. There's a generation of activists, civil servants and ministers who were in there to actually serve the public, who are loyal to the constitution, not just to the party, but to the constitution, and that is possible. So it's an attempt to inspire young people to actually go into the public service to serve the nation and not to make money.
That was activist and former GCIS CEO Themba Maseko in conversation with Polity about his book titled For My Country, Why I Blew the Whistle on Zuma and the Guptas.